بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين محمد رسول الله صلى الله عليه وآله وصحبه وسلم تسليما كثيرا كثيرا فما بعد My dear brothers and sisters, I'm sitting here end of November out in the open, and of course you can see from the picture the trees have no leaves and so on, so we know it is winter, but that's about it. I mean, even the wind is not cold. It's nice and nippy, but it's definitely nothing like what winter should be in this part of the world. Alhamdulillah, much to be grateful for. Much as I like the snow, it's also nice not to have it. And of course, here the beautiful clear skies. Water behind me is a little inlet from Long Island Sound, and yesterday it had two adult swans with two juveniles on them, on the water. It was absolutely fabulous. The way they were swimming like in a square grid. So there was like a diamond shape. The little wakes that they made with their swimming. The male swan was in the front and he was coming along like a galleon in full sail. And then on two points were the two juveniles, and at the back was the mother. It was a supremely phenomenal sight, subhanAllah. I'm most grateful to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala jalla jalalu that he gives me the opportunity to see these things, and I try in whatever way I can to share His glory and magnificence with you. The creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is a sign of His glory and His magnificence, and most of all of His rahmah, of His mercy. And the best and biggest sign of the glory and magnificence of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and of His rahmah, of His mercy and His forgiveness, is Muhammadur Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam. He is the Imamul Anbiya, He is the Sayyidul Mursaleen, He is the best of the creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala jalla jalaluhu, and He is the one who Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala specifically named and called His ni'mah. Every single thing that we have in our life, no matter how much we take it for granted, is the ni'mah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, is a blessing of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Starting with the air we breathe, which is literally the difference between life and death in this world, which Corona brought very graphically and drastically to our attention, because people who die from Corona, and we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to cure all those who are affected by it, and we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to protect all those who are not affected by it. People who die from Corona are people who die of respiratory failure. And which means that they cannot breathe. So every breath we take, and I want you to do this as an exercise, take two deep breaths. Now thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for that. Thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that you and I are able to breathe freely without any hindrance. Whereas there are people as we speak who are lying in oxygen tents and hooked onto ventilators, who are struggling to get a single breath of air into their lungs. Everything is the mercy and is the blessing of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But as I said, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did not say that the air you breathe is my ni'mah, the water you drink is my ni'mah, the food you eat is my ni'mah. Allah didn't call these things His ni'mat. He called one His ni'mat. And that also Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala just didn't call ni'mah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala emphasized, Allah said, verily and truly. And what is that ni'mah and who's that ni'mah? That ni'mah is Muhammadur Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. In our class today of Akhlaaq of the Ummati, I want you to understand this first and foremost. And I want you to sit where you are sitting and to introspect and to go into yourself and ask yourself this question and say, what is my understanding about Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam? What is my understanding that Allah, that Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam is a ni'mah of Allah for me? How do I relate to that? What is my connection with Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam? I want you to seriously think about this very deeply and feel it. And if you cannot feel it, then I want you to, you know, is really cry and weep before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Stand in tahajjud, go in sujood, weep before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and say, Allah, what has happened to me? Why is it that I am unable to feel this ni'mah that you have sent me? What will happen to me when I stand before you on the day of judgment? And you ask me, what did you do with the ni'mah that I sent you? And that ni'mah was Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam. Now let me give you my dalil. How do I say that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is the ni'mah of Allah? I don't say that. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said it. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, لَقَدْ مَنَّ اللَّهُ عَلَى الْمُؤْمِنِينَ إِذْ بَعَثَ فِيهِمْ رَسُولًا مِّنْ أَنفُسِهِمْ. Allah said, verily and truly, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala blessed the mu'mineen. He gave them a ni'mah. لَقَدْ مَنَّ اللَّهَ. Verily and truly, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave a ni'mah to the mu'mineen. عَلَى الْمُؤْمِنِينَ. On the believers. إِذْ بَعَثَ فِيهِمْ. When He brought out from them, إِذْ بَعَثَ فِيهِمْ. رَسُولًا مِنْ أَنفُسِهِمْ. A Rasul from among them. So the ni'mah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is twofold, double ni'mah. One, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent His Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam to us. That is a ni'mah. And the second ni'mah is that Allah said, my Nabi is from among you, meaning that He is a human being. For the Sahaba, He is an Arab. He is from your own people. And for us, inshallah, even though we are not Arab, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying, he's a human being. So therefore, He is from you. Allah did not send an alien. Allah did not send one of the malak. He didn't send an angel. He didn't create a new being to send, which that being would have had nothing in common with us. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent a human being. So Allah said, I have blessed you and I have blessed you double. I have blessed you twice. One, that I sent my Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to you. And second, that this Nabi is from among you. Right? So we feel this. For example, just this morning, my dear friend and brother Azhar sent me a picture of Prince Mufakkam Jabahadur. Now, Prince Mufakkam Jabahadur is the grandson, meaning he is the paternal grandson of the Nizam of Hyderabad, Mir Usman Ali Khan Bahadur. And he is the maternal grandson of Sultan Abdul Hamid, the last Sultan of the Ottoman Empire. The mother of Prince Mufakkam Jabahadur was Her Highness Princess Durrashahwar, rahmatullahi alayha, the daughter of Sultan Abdul Hamid, rahmatullahi alayhi. And his father, Prince Mufakkam Jabahadur's father, was Prince Azam Jabahadur, and Azam Jabahadur's father was our Nizam, Mir Usman Ali Khan. Now, my point is that I, as a Hyderabadi, I have nothing to do with them. I am not related to the Nizam of Hyderabad, and I am not related to the Ottoman Sultan. So my relationship in terms of my lineage and my bloodline or anything, I have zero. I have absolutely no relationship with either of these people. But somehow, because I am Hyderabadi, I feel some sense of, you know, reflected glory, if you call it. I mean, you can think I'm stupid, no problem. Believe me, there are a lot of stupid people like me, at least my generation. And interestingly, that is not restricted to the Muslims. People of my generation, even the Hindus, even the Reddys, from the old families of Hyderabad, they feel a sense of pride that here is our prince. He doesn't even know we exist, but we feel, okay, here is our prince. And he has this wonderful lineage. He's related to these two great dynasties of the world. The reason I'm giving you this example, and of course the Nabi of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam is beyond any example that we can give. The reason I'm giving you this example is that when somebody great and magnificent is somehow related in some way, right? In some way to a people, those people feel a sense of pride that we are from, that this person is from us. See all the celebrations happening in India because Kamala Harris is the vice president designate of the United States of America. Suddenly all the Indians woke up to the fact, oh, but you know, she is Indian. Now, don't worry about the fact that she never said, I'm Indian. She always says, I'm black. She always says, I'm African. Her father is from the West Indies. But her mother was Indian. Her mother was from Tamil Nadu. But everybody, she is one of us. Yeah, my point is, the reason I gave these examples, again, as I said, we are not comparing any of them to the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. But the reason I gave you this example is for you to try to think about and say that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala jalla jalaluhu said, my Nabi is from you. Ba'asa fihim rasulam min anfusihim. My Nabi is from you, is from them. And this is the ni'mah of Allah, this is the blessing of Allah. What sense of relationship do we have with that? I want you to think about this, my brothers and sisters, because this is a very, very critical thing for us to do. And this is why the akhlaaq of the Ummati, what is the akhlaaq of the Ummati? The akhlaaq of the Ummati is the akhlaaq of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, my Nabi is from you, meaning, be like him. لَقَدْ كَانَ لَكُمْ Fi Rasulillahi Uswatun Hasana. For you, the best example is who? Is the same Nabi who is from you, who was sent to you, and he was extracted from you, he belongs to you. Become like him. Why do I say that this is Allah's, as Rahmanur Rahimu fi dunya wal akhirah, this is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's greatest sign of his rahmah? Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent this Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam among us, and what did he say about him? وَمَا أَرْسَلْنَاكَ إِلَّا رَحْمَةً لِلْعَالَمِينَ. Allah says, I have not sent you for anything other than as a mercy to all the universe. What do we understand about charity? What do we understand about responsibility? What do we understand where goodness should begin from? From the closest circle. Be charitable, be good, be nice to those who are closest to you. Yes, Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam is a mercy to all of mankind. There's no doubt about that. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala declared that. But where does that mercy begin from? From us. Because he is from us. He was sent to us. He is from us. So this mercy begins with us. Now tell me, isn't that a magnificent sign of the greatness and glory and magnificence of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala jalla jalal? And that's why I said he is the biggest sign. And the point I want to make for you is this. that what is our relationship to that? The fact that Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam is the sign of the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, how does it connect with me as an abd of Allah, as a slave of Allah, and as an ummati of Muhammadur Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? This is what you need to think about, and this is what I need to think about. And how he relates to us is not a factor of celebrating his milad. It is not a factor of reciting some naat or nasheed. It is not a sign of shedding some tears when you listen to a naat or nasheed, you know, beautiful poetry. It is reflected only in one thing, which is our attitude towards the sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Do I value the sunnah of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam? Do I practice the sunnah of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam? That's it, nothing else. And if I say, yes, I value the sunnah, what is the evidence of that? Do I practice the sunnah? I cannot claim to value something that I do not practice. So if I value the sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, then the evidence of my value is that I practice the sunnah of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to grant this to us. I ask Allah to put this love for Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam in our hearts. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to enable us to show our appreciation for this beautiful ni'mah that he gave us, for this greatest of his blessings that he gave us. And he reiterated us, and he reiterated that, and he reiterated that, and he emphasized it. And he said, this is my blessing on you. I ask Allah to enable us to appreciate it and to show the appreciation by practicing the sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam in our lives, day and night, in everything we do, knowing that not only does it earn the blessing and earn the pleasure of Allah, but it is the most beautiful thing that we can do for ourselves. It is the best thing that we can do for ourselves. My brothers and sisters, along with that, to continue the ayah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala then mentioned four things that he set for Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam as his responsibility. Yatlu alayhim ayatihi wa yuzakkihim wa yuallimuhumul kitaba wal hikmah. Four things. Recite for them the ayat of Allah. Recite for them his ayat. Whose ayat? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's ayat. The revelation, the Quran that is sent to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Inform the people what you have received. Yatru alayhim ayatihi wa yuzakkihim. And purify the people. External purification, wudu, ghusl, body, clothes, space, and internal purification, which is tazkiyatun nafs. Tazkiyatun nafs wa tarbiyatul akhlaq. Internal purification of the intention, in purification of the heart, purification of the soul, and external purification, which is physical in terms of the body, clothing, and so on, and purification of the akhlaq, purification of manners, purification of dealing, purification of interaction, purification of speech. Tazkiyatun nafs wa tarbiyatul akhlaq. This was given to Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Yatlu alayhim ayatihi wa yuzakkihim wa yuallimuhumul kitab, and teach them the book. Which book? Which has already been recited for them. Yatlu alayhim ayatihi wa yuzakkihim wa yuallimuhumul kitab. Which kitab? This kitab, which was recited to them already. Wal hikmah, and teach them wisdom. Teach them wisdom. What is wisdom? Wisdom relates to the application of what they learned in the kitab, which is also, in a broader context, the sunnah, the behavior, the speech, the teachings, what Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, what he did, what he permitted, his ahwal, his conditions, his life, internal, external, all of this is under the hikmah of Rasulullah. Now, this was the responsibility of the Nabi alayhi salam, and it is our belief and it is a proven historical documented fact that he completed this and he fulfilled that to a level of excellence, alhamdulillah. Then, how does it relate to us? Is this some story that I'm telling you about Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, a nice story, and we go home? Or does this relate to you and me as people? The way it relates to us is, for each one of these four things, يَتْلُوْ عَلَيْهِمْ آيَاتِهِ وَيُزَكِّهِمْ وَيُعَلِّمُهُمُ الْكِتَابَ وَالْحِكْمَةِ. Recite for them the ayat of Allah, purify them, internal and external, teach them the book and hikmah, the wisdom of the book. For each of these four things, there has to be a concomitant response from our side as people, each of these. So, يَتْلُوْ عَلَيْهِمْ آيَاتِهِ, when Rasulullah ﷺ recites the Quran, in our case today, when we read the Quran, his responsibility is to recite, our responsibility is to listen and learn. So here now when we are reading the Quran, imagine that this Quran which you are reading is being recited to you by Rasulullah ﷺ as he did with the Sahaba Ridwanullahi alayhim ajma'in. Try to hear the voice of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam reciting the Quran. May I ask Allah to give you that, inshallah. May you hear the recitation of the Quran bisawti al-qari Muhammad Mustafa sallallahu alaihi wa alihi wasallam in the beautiful voice of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant that to you in a way that he knows best, in keeping with his majesty and grace. So what must I do when I listen to the Quran? I must pay attention. Don't have the Quran praying as background music while you are chatting and talking and whatnot. People have the Quran running in the car the whole time. Now, if you are driving and you are listening to the Quran on your own, fine, alhamdulillah, that's very good. But if there is somebody else in the car with you and you are having this conversation and the Quran is playing in the background, this is lack of adab. This is disrespectful. Turn it off. Finish your conversation. Otherwise, keep quiet and listen to the Quran. So, يَتْلُوْ عَلَيْهِمْ آيَاتِ وَيُزَكِّيهِمْ. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was told to purify us. What is our job today? To purify ourselves according to how Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam taught us to purify ourselves. As I mentioned to you, and I mentioned to you again and again, the purification refers to the internal purification of the heart, intentions, motivations, attitudes, and it refers to the external purification, starting with myself, which is my body, my clothing, my surroundings, my home, and extending to my behavior, my speech. And remember, we can all make mistakes. Please, nobody is perfect. So you make a mistake, Make istighfar, make tawbah, start again. No problem. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala promised to forgive. That's it. So now, what must we do? Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told us to purify, so we purify ourselves. يُعَلِّمُهُمُ الْكِتَاب. He was told to teach the kitab. What must we do? Learn the kitab. Meaning, first of all, starting with the fundamental thing, learn Arabic language. I know it's a very, very difficult language, but it is there. So we learn the language. We try to learn the language. And while we are learning the language, people like us, and even for the Arabs, for a lot of Arabs, it's the mother tongue, but they don't know classical Arabic. They still have to learn the language. So those of us who do not know the language enough to understand the Quran in its actual revealed context, then we must read the translations of the Quran, and we must read the tafsir or the exegesis of the Quran, and do that, read the classical scholars first, and try to understand that, and as far as possible, to the best of your ability, learn from a scholar. Learn from a scholar. What is not permitted is for us to simply read a translation of the Quran and do our own tafsir and say, oh, this is what it means to me. This is what I think it means. Please, do not destroy yourself. What it means to you has no validity in Islam, because we do not have the basic fundamental knowledge base even to understand the words of the Quran. The Quran is the words, the Quran is the grammar, the Quran is the context of the revelation, in what circumstances it was revealed. The Quran is how Rasulullah ﷺ explained it. The Quran is how the Sahaba understood it. Now, all of these together, believe me, people sitting there making tafsir classes and talking about these things, how many of them know this, know all of this? I'm not saying nobody knows. Those who know, alhamdulillah, good for you. Those who don't know, run like hell, because you are playing games with the word of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Make istighfar, make tawbah. Don't do that. Simplest thing is pick up a mustarad tafsir, pick up a good, valid tafsir from one of our great scholars and simply read that. There is no need for you to bring yourself into that. So, yu'allimu al-kitab wal-hikmah. Hikmah is the sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Do I practice this sunnah? My brothers and sisters, today the great tragedy is that even in our madaris and Darul Uloom, in our jamiat, in our religious schools, which we like to call seminaries, this itself is a tragedy. It's a tragedy how we have become so enslaved to especially the English language. And the solution is not to reject the language. The solution is to use the language. It's a tool. We simply take words and we use them without applying our minds. How do you call a Islamic college a seminary? Go look up the meaning. What is a seminary? A seminary is a place where you train priests in a religion where there is no priesthood. How can you have a seminary? How can you have a seminary? And what is the problem with using a word like jamia? What is the problem with using a simple word like college? Where you have no priests, how do you have a seminary? It's just we simply take things from another language and we apply them. This is the reason why I'm saying this. Just using the language alone is not sufficient. We have to apply our brains. The point I'm making is that even in these places, and again, as I told you, I'm not speaking on behalf of all the institutions in the world. I'm sure there are exceptions, and I hope there are exceptions, and I hope those exceptions become the rule. But until that happens, the majority of them, and of course all the ones that I have gone to in India, in South Africa, in the Middle East, in the UK, their curriculum has, out of the four things, what were the four things? Recite the Quran. Number two, purification, tazkiyatun nafs, tarbiyatul akhlaq. Three, teach the Quran. Yu'allimuhumul kitab. Four, hikmah, the sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Out of these four things, we have one and we have three. Two and four are completely absent. We have recitation of the Quran. There's huge focus on recitation. There is huge focus on, they teach you, first of all, they teach you tajweed. There is massive focus on tajweed, and alhamdulillah, it is very good. We should do it. There is nothing nice and nothing good about reciting the Quran wrong. We must learn how to recite it well and correctly. There is a lot of focus on tilawat of Quran in the different styles of recitation. But when we come to tazkiyatun nafs, purification of the soul, missing, zero. It is not even a subject in the curriculum. There is no period in the timetable for tazkiyatun nafs. I don't mean to say that tazkiyatun nafs is supposed to be one period in the day. where you should teach it, but I'm saying, where is it? Where is it? Totally absent. Who are the ulama? Who are the teachers who can teach tazkiyatun nafs? Who are they in your jamia, in your darul ulum? Are they doing that? Zero. So therefore, how do I deal with arrogance? How do I deal with jealousy? How do I deal with hatred? How do I deal with insecurity? How do I deal with my own emotional immaturity? Right? And I'm not even making an exhaustive list of the evil of the soul. There is a series of my Fajr reminders, totally 50 of them, on Tazkiyatun Nafs and Tarbiyatul Akhlaq. Please listen to all of them. So my point is that that whole subject is missing. Zero. Then we have Ta'limul Kitab. Yu'allimuhul Kitab. Of course, we teach different tafasir. We teach translations. We have, in some places, we also have Arabic language, and I'm saying some places very clearly, because in other places the Arabic language itself is not taught, but in many places it is taught. And then we have with that we have therefore the teaching of tafsir and translations, and then sunnah of Rabbi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, again missing. Even hadith, which is taught in bits and pieces, cherry picking. We do not teach the usul of hadith before we teach hadith, the fundamentals of it. Now, and then, of course, there's a huge amount of focus usually on fiqh. And in today's world, because Islamic banking is a place where, which has pays the best salaries, everybody is into Islamic banking. Now, my point is this the way to learn deen? So we end up now with a situation where we have people who use Google as their source of knowledge for Islam. So they go on to Google and they search. Now think about this. Somebody searches in Salah, what are the Arkan, what are the Fara'id, what are the Sunan, what are the Mustahabat. Having searched, this person, he finds out. So many arkan, so many faraiz, so many sunnah, so many mustahabat. So now, as far as the knowledge part is concerned, he knows. Now what does he do? He decides for himself that since leaving a sunnah of salah does not invalidate the salah, it does not even necessitate making sajda sahu, according to one opinion. Even if he does it deliberately, he decides to leave the sunnah of salah. Now, what kind of salah is that? Where somebody is deliberately not doing a sunnah of the salah. Why? Because he got knowledge. Imagine the same fellow, the same misguided creature, before he got this knowledge, he was praying like his mother taught him, like his father taught him. The mother did not know all of this whole thing of, you know, how many arkan, how many faraid, how many sunnah. She taught him how to pray the way her mother taught her. Even the mother did not know. That mother learned from her mother. Even that mother did not know. So we have this whole list of jahiloon who were performing the salah correctly. Right? I mean that jahilun with the enormous amount of respect and love for these people. May Allah bless them. They followed the deen blindly, and may this be the means of Jannatul Firdaus without hisab for them. They did it because they loved Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi, because they loved Allah Subhanahu Wa Ta'ala. But now you have this new generation which decides to use Google as his sheikh. So he goes and searches now, or she goes and searches now on this Google. And they discover all this terminology. Ask them, please describe for me. You figure it all, right? So please define what is mustahab. I bet you 99% of them cannot define. They do not know the meaning of the term. They're using terms, they don't even know the meaning of the term, the definition of the term. Just read it on Google. So now you read on Google that to deliberately leave a sunnah does not invalidate your salah. So now you got this knowledge, right? So you can do one of two things with this knowledge. Think about it. That is the reason I'm saying tazkiyatun nafs is so critically important. Once you get this knowledge of how many faraid, how many arkan, how many arkan, how many faraid, how many sunnah, how many mustahabat in salah, you have two choices. Knowledge-wise, you got the right knowledge. You got the right knowledge. I've got no quarrel with the knowledge. The knowledge is right. But you got two choices. Choice one. I say to myself, Subhanallah, Alhamdulillah, Allah gave me this knowledge. Now I am going to make sure that in my salah, I actually practice every single one of these. As I am praying, I am going to be conscious that I want to do this salah absolutely perfectly the way Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam taught us. Because what did he say? He said, Sallu kama ra'aytumuni usalli. He said, pray as you have seen me pray. Therefore, in his prayer, he would have done the arkan, he would have done the faraid, he would have done the sunan, he would have done the mustahabat. So I am going to make sure, now that I know these things, I am going to make sure that I do every single one of them perfectly. This is one choice. And the second choice, the shaitani choice, what is that? The shaitani choice is, oh wow, fantastic. Now I discovered how I can shorten my salah, just dump it and go off. And what do? I will just do the arkan of salah. Just the pillars of salah. I will just do the fara'id of salah and the sunan and the mustahabat. Salaam alaikum. No problem. After all, I now have Mr. Google's fatwa to say that my salah is valid, my salah is not invalidated, and when I am produced before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, I will write in my will, please take a printout of this and put it in my khabar next to my skin under my kafan, and when I go before Allah, I will pull out this and I will say, Ya Allah, here is my fatwa to say that my salah was valid. Right? Your salah is valid, believe me. But go figure this one out. Go figure out how you are going to answer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Why you deliberately left out a beautiful sunnah of His Habib Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam. When in your stupidity and that knowledge which you got, which you thought was knowledge but which was from shaitan, you knew that following that sunnah is ibadah. You knew that following that sunnah was something that would have taken you into Jannah. You deliberately dropped that, you deliberately left it. How much time did you save, and did you really save that time? Because that time would have saved you from Jahannam. But you decided to leave that sunnah. Deliberately you decided to leave that sunnah. I want to close with another factual thing which I want to share with you. And that is, I'm not talking about leaving out. I'm talking about doing. And that is, what is the hukum for somebody who recites Durood Ibrahim by mistake, out of forgetfulness, in the first tashahud of a 4-rakat salah? Right? So in 4-rakat of salah, the first tashahud, anyway, the first tashahud is not a rukun. So in that first tashahud, after finishing attahiyyat, I should have stood up for the third rakat. I forgot. I also recited Durood Ibrahim. Then I realized. So I stood up and I completed my salah. Now, is sajda sahu, first of all, is my salah valid? Or has this invalidated my salah? Second thing is, okay, my salah is valid, but should I make sajda sahu for this because I added something? What is sajda sahu? Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said, if you add something or subtract something out of forgetfulness, yeah, he's not talking about deliberately leaving something. That's why I said deliberately leaving is from shaitan. Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, what's the hadith about sajda sahu? He said, if you add something or you leave out something out of forgetfulness, he said, make two sajda. So out of forgetfulness, now I added something, which is I recited the durood of Ibrahim alayhi salam. Durood Ibrahim, which is Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, durood on him. There are two opinions. One opinion is, you need not make sajda sahu. Nobody said you did a great thing. We are just saying, okay, you forgot, so it's okay, but it is something which does not necessitate, it does not invalidate your salah, and it does not necessitate sajda sahu. But there is another opinion, equally valid, which says that you should make sajda sahu because your reciting the durood out of forgetfulness was an act of lack of adab for Rasulullah. It was a sign that you did that out of forgetfulness because it means that you forgot about this. And therefore, it necessitates you to do a sajda sahu. This is what I mean by tazkiyatun nafs. This is the issue of the intention. This is the issue of the reality of the deed. It's not a matter of the rule. It's a matter of the spirit behind the rule. It's not the law. It is the spirit behind the law, which really makes the law the law. It makes the law what it is. But why is it we don't understand this? Because we approach the deen in an incorrect way. So shaitan uses the deen to misguide us and take us into Jahannam. Illa mashallah, we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for forgiveness. Now, brothers and sisters, please get serious with life. Please get serious with life, because the day will come when you and I will stand before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And on that day, we do not want Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to ask us this question and say, why did you disrespect my Nabi by deliberately not reciting durood when you knew that if you recite durood once, I send salam on you 10 times. Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, the one who sends salat and salam on me one time, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will send salat and salam on that person 10 times. And here is a person who deliberately leaves that. What salah is that? What Islam is that? What iman is that? What shaitaniyat is that? And why does that happen? Because of this completely ridiculous approach to deen, where we think that just going to Google and finding out is enough. Please get serious with your life, because one day this life will go. One day this life will go. And then we'll stand before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We'll stand naked. There will be nobody to help you. I cannot help you. You cannot help me. Nobody in the world can help you. And you will be on your own. I will be on my own. Let us fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's anger. Let us learn about this deen, and let us learn to practice this deen in a way that pleases Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Jalla jalla. Wa sallallahu ala nabiyil kareem wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in bi rahmatika ya arhamar rahimin. والحمد لله رب العالمين والسلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.